It's time for Side Scrollers from Screw Attack with your hosts, Stuttering Craig.
But part of the celebration is also playing Ultimate Party Challenge for the Wii and listening to the greatest hits from the early 1990s.
Chad.
Hey, Chad!
And Professional Jared.
Challenge for you guys!
And now, broadcasting from the World Screw Attack headquarters in Dallas, Texas, it's the Side Scrollers.
Welcome to Side Scrollers on ScrewAttack.com. What's going on, everybody? Hi. I'm Stuttering Craig.
I'm Chad.
And I'm Professional Jared.
Joining you this week for the most entertaining 30 to 45 minutes of your video game week, it is Side Scrollers on ScrewAttack.com and YouTube. Hey, YouTube, what's going on? Good to see you. All right, so a busy week this week, man.
Elvis there?
No.
What's going on?
It was just kind of like, what's up, guys? How's it going? That's all. Hey, YouTube, good to see you.
All right.
Anyways, is everybody happy this week? Because I'm ready.
I am happy and ready, apparently.
Man, oh man.
I'm thrown off by daylight savings time.
It's all over the place.
Yeah. I was up way too late playing Dragon Age 2, and I figured, oh, the next day I'm going to do the same thing. But then I woke up an hour later and just threw off my entire system.
Yeah, it's pretty weird when I was driving back from Austin, Texas,
and
it went from 1:59 to 3 a.m., which was very
odd. I'm like, yeah, this will be all right. Oh,
it was very weird. But yes, daylight savings time is in full effect right now, so we sprung forward an hour.
It's the worst one.
Yes, so let's spring forward and talk about things that are coming up on the site this week.
Oh, that's your segue?
Oh, you're so clever.
Ah, it's horrible. All right, coming up on the site, we have a death battle, which you can watch on YouTube right now. It is Yoshi versus Riptor in a battle of dino death. We have how many lives on Hardcore Uprising? It is Jose's turn to conquer the gauntlet that is level 1 up to the giant sand worm.
Yeah.
And then a mystery challenger will partake in how many lives coming soon. Also, this week, I will be not here most of the week as I'm getting my nose chopped off. Or at least beat up.
Just gets worse.
Slowly, eventually my head will just be, I'll just be decapitated. Yeah. So yeah,
it's gonna be a hat.
Yep, just a hat on my neck, that's it. So yes, I'll be out of the office. So I'm looking forward to see what you guys come with over the next, you know.
Oh, we've got ideas already.
Good, good.
We've been talking.
Excellent.
It's called Embarrassing Stories About Craig Time.
Oh, that's good. Well, who's gonna recreate them? Yeah, exactly.
Dang it.
So anyways, definitely it's going to be fun. So if you make sure you go to Screw Attack and watch all the fun videos there. You notice we have seen a little bit of our videos on YouTube for all you YouTube viewers, but I would not expect a whole lot of that stuff on YouTube right now. If you want to see all of our videos, make sure you go to ScrewAttack.com. All right. So we have all everything. Let's see, what do I usually do here? I usually go to hard news, but I feel like I'm missing something here. I feel like I'm missing something.
I don't know.
How about the new top 10?
Oh crap, yeah, the new top 10's up. Yeah, top 10 worst doctors in video games, which, hey, that's fun.
It sure is.
Malpractice is hilarious.
It's probably one of the most controversial finishes we've had to a top 10 ever.
Well, I think it's brilliant.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks, appreciate that. Yeah. So, that's what we got going up. You can see that over on Game Trailers right now. Top 10 worst doctors in America. But right now it's time for, I guess in video games, not America. But it's time for my favorite segment, your favorite segment.
I love it.
Everybody in the world's favorite segment. Brian?
Yeah?
It's time for
Hard News. All the day's news from this past week. It's time for Hard News.
I love our transitions.
Alright.
Okay, hard news time.
Yes,
hey,
it is. I already did.
We've all seen some video game movies, right?
Yeah.
And they are pretty terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we're going to be seeing some new ones, or rather some reboots of some of the more popular franchises.
Okay.
Have you guys ever watched any of the Tomb Raider movies?
Yeah.
No.
Actually, I've never saw a Tomb Raider one.
No desire.
Really? I never saw any of those. But it has been confirmed that they are going to be doing a new Tomb Raider movie, and it's going to be a reboot of the movie franchise.
Yeah. I didn't hear, is Angelina Jolie?
Well, I would guess not. I mean, if they're gonna say it's a movie reboot, I would imagine they're gonna get some new blood or something.
If
If you allow me to reuse my joke from Hard News this past week, I don't believe her fake boobs and fake lips have been confirmed. So that's my joke from last week's
podcast. Oh, okay.
When I reported that on the story. But yeah, I hear you.
But yeah, so there's an all-new Tomb Raider movie. It's going to be a reboot of the franchise, whatever that means. I don't even think it was that big of a franchise to consider it a reboot. But also coming out of the rumor mill is a brand new Doom movie.
Oh, really?
See, okay.
Not with The Rock this time?
No.
Probably not.
And the big force gun?
Yes.
Bioforce gun.
Oh, is that what it was? The Bioforce
gun? That's what it stands
for. Bioforce gun.
I thought it was a big force gun. But yeah, you know, but real quick, you said Tomb Raider, you didn't think it was that big of a franchise. Well, I don't think it was a big franchise to gamers, but I think it was. I think it actually did pretty well in the box office. I think.
I think it did. It did okay.
I mean, they made like seven of them. So
weren't there like three?
Yeah, I thought they made like a bunch of them.
They had two movies.
Two? Okay.
Yeah, they had Tomb Raider and Tomb Raider
Cradle of Life.
Yeah.
Good enough to make a
now,
sequel.
Now, with the Doom reboot movie, there, I'm sure. Do you guys ever see the first Doom movie, by the way?
Yeah.
No.
Really?
No, I've just seen trailers.
Had the first person shooter segment.
That was so strange.
It lasted all of 5 minutes. It was totally weird. But I imagine they're going to be doing something very similar to that with the reboot, because the new Doom movie is probably going to be in 3D.
All right.
Yeah. So it's like,
yay.
It's like Doom, the game, the movie, in 3D.
All right.
I'm still, you know me in 3D.
Yep, that's me too. Well, that's cool, I guess.
All right.
I don't really have much to say.
Okay, next story.
I'm not going to go see them.
Yeah.
All right, next story.
Uh-huh.
Saints Row 3. I'm actually a pretty big fan of the Saints Row franchise. I've always liked it more than Grand Theft Auto, and one of my favorite things about it has been the cooperative mode that they put in Saints Row 2. Now, they're saying that the new Saints Row 3 is going to maintain the same cooperative mode.
You mean Saints Row the Third?
Whatever. That's going to have TBD in it. But there's not going to be any sort of competitive multiplayer whatsoever. The developer says that the co-op is still going to be in the game, but multiplayer is not as important as co-op. What do you guys think about that?
Multiplayer, let me process that. Multiplayer is not as important as co-op. Well, that makes a little bit of sense, I guess.
Well, you're saying the competitive multiplayer mode, like the deathmatch, the capture the flag kind of style modes, they're not going to have those at all. They're going to be concentrating solely on a cooperative experience.
Kind of sounds good.
Well, I mean, that's kind of cool because, I mean, there's not that many games that focus on co-op nowadays. But, I mean, people love the multiplayer.
Well.
Like, when it comes to Grand Theft Auto, I mean, I know everybody has all those crazy antics of fun, and I always see videos of just like random shit happening. I don't think they should take it out of the game. So.
But you could say that as opposed to focusing on a co-op as opposed to a multiplayer, you could say that games are kind of going to that, especially with like a horde mode, because you know there's going to be a competitive mode that someone's going to win out of it. Like let's say it's like destroy the most cars in the city or whatever, someone's going to have to be a winner. But you look at a game like Bulletstorm. And Bulletstorm, their multiplayer is strictly horde mode. That's pretty much what it is. But it's team working together to have a goal, but there is a winner.
I was kind of bummed out by that because I'm not going to lie.
Exactly.
I wanted to go against people and I wanted to laser whip and boot them.
Yeah,
you know, like,
but I don't think it's that rare though.
Well, that's one of the reasons why I actually picked this story, because it seems like with this generation in particular that the cooperative gameplay has gotten a big rise. I mean, you look at the co-op and say, like they put a lot more in like Gears of War, like the horde mode you're talking about.
Right.
Earth Defense Force for a random obscure one, but a lot more games are getting cooperative modes. Even the Call of Duty games started having cooperative modes, whether it's zombies or the story mode or
that was a big
whatever.
Deal.
Yeah,
when Call of Duty got it,
yeah,
when they did the four-player co-op, people freaked out about that.
So, I'm actually really happy about this. The fact that co-op is getting more into the forefront makes me happy because I've always said I'm not the most competitive person in the world, and I've always preferred to play with my friends than against them. So I'm all for co-op. This story makes me happy.
That's good. I'm very indifferent towards it, so...
All right.
Just give me a gun, let me shoot things.
Gotcha.
I'm a gamer! Grr, grr.
Alright, last story. This one's a little more controversial.
Uh-oh.
Now, we guys all know about Angry Birds, right?
Yeah.
Alright. Now, the Angry Birds, developer, the boss, made the great...
This is the movie.
He made the great statement saying that the South by Southwest thing that's going on in Texas... last week and
Austin.
This week.
Yeah.
He said that the console industry and their games is dying.
The dude made one game.
He suggested that console games cost way too much and require way too much effort to upgrade, and because of that entire industry is dying. And yes, that's exactly why I brought this up, because the dude made one game and it happened to do well, and now he's like, atop his ivory tower, looking down upon the peasants and making fun of them.
Well, look, the company's obviously huge now because the game has
done
so well.
Oh yeah, they made a crap ton of money.
The game sold like millions of copies of the game at a buck a piece, right? But then they also did like Angry Birds the Halloween version, Angry Birds the Christmas version. It's the same fucking game over and over again. And this guy, like, you're making a game about birds being shot out of a freaking slingshot hitting pigs. Okay, that's funny, but what gives you the, you're not Miyamoto, man, sorry, you know?
His name is Peter Vesterbacka. Vesterbacka?
Doesn't quite roll off the tongue like Miyamoto.
Quite not, no. But anyway, so he was pretty much saying that the games is dying, and even though he's currently in, like, this whole apps business, which there really is no, like, well-sustained formula that works. Like, it's always all kind of over the place. Like, there's a crap ton of app games out there, but how many of them really have lasting appeal or are actually really, really good? Plus, at the same time, there's so very little risk because they're only going to cost $2 a piece.
Okay, yeah. Here's the thing. Speaking from experience with texting the bread, right? There is, the app world is so hard to get into unless you are a big publisher. Like as an indie guy, like very rarely you hear about all these indie games that are a success, but what you don't hear about is the hundreds of thousands. who some just shovel crap out there, but there's some really good games out there that don't get the due they deserve, and they are pushed down by, guess what? The EAs, the Activisions, the guys with the huge budgets, you know? And yeah, a game like, you know, Angry Birds has been a huge hit, but they've used their money properly to position themselves to where if they were to ever make a game other than Angry Birds, they could probably position themselves to where it could hit the top of the charts because now they have money, you know? Yeah. So, and that's what it really comes down to. But at the end of the day, the same companies that are making those games for the consoles are still the ones that are making the games for the... for the iPhones and
that's a good point.
You know, they're the exact same companies. This guy's a dumbass.
Yeah. Yep. That's
a story.
Final verdict. This guy's a dumbass. I'm gonna go with that.
Make
the consoles are dying because the iPhone is the platform for the hardcore gamer, right?
Oh yeah.
Make more of a game that with dialogue that consists more of meh, then you know we can talk. How's that?
All right. Okay. Those are my stories.
That drives me nuts. All right. Okay, good. Good stuff. Well, that's hard news for this week. Thanks for riling me up. Appreciate that.
Now that you're heart enraged.
Now you know what also riles me up?
What?
What?
The topic wheel! Oh, okay. Let's go, Chad. Give it a big spin!
What will it be? I didn't even read the topics.
Ooh, Zelda memories.
Oh, Zelda memories.
Nice. All right.
Oscar Skaggett.
Please. Well, in case you guys don't know, it was recently Zelda's 25-year anniversary.
Really?
And with that anniversary, let's talk about some of our favorite moments that we've had with the beloved franchise.
Ah. Now, immediately, first thing that comes to mind is the white ring and red ring from the original Zelda.
That's a memory for you?
Yes, it is.
Why?
Because I thought it was so cool that you could power up and actually gain strength from those rings. And I always thought the white ring was the white ring, but you looked blue on the screen, which something I always thought was, I always thought the guy looked blue, so I always thought it was
the
blue ring.
You get the blue ring and it makes
it
look whitish.
Okay, bingo, flip them. Yeah, the blue ring and the red ring, yeah. So I thought the blue ring was always really cool, but because it was really hard to get. You had to get like 255
that's a lot of
rupees and you had to farm and farm, whatever. You don't farm when you're six.
Well, there is, I mean, technically it is.
Well. No, it was going around and killing guys.
It
wasn't farming. It was going around and killing guys. At the, you know?
That's, well, yeah.
Farming is something that's popped up in the last 5 years.
Modern day lingo being applied to the retro.
Yes. And the red ring, which was, you could only get in, I think it was Ganon's castle or something.
Yep.
So, you know, you could only get it at the very, very end. Those are my two earliest memories. I think I just enjoyed those the most because I was like, oh, Link's in red now. That's awesome. Yes. You know, oh, he looks
like a badass.
Looks so different. He's not green anymore. Sweet. You know, so I thought that was really, really cool. But you know, fun story. A lot of people want to know about, you know, the story behind Screw Attack and the name, how we came up with the name. And we actually talked about this several times. But Zelda was actually one of the first things we looked at for power-ups for the website name, and Red Ring was one of them, which Red Ring was a reference to you know, the Red Ring in Zelda, right, yeah. But Red Ring nowadays actually means something totally different, a la the Xbox 360 Red Ring of Death.
Well, so that would have been weird.
It would have worked in so many ways.
But entire website's defective.
Redring.com. We knew it was going to happen.
So we decided to go with Screw Attack anyways, and the rest is history. So.
That's cool.
With the original Zelda, one of my first memories, I have a twin brother, and we always play the games together. But, you know, at the screen, you know, where you put in your name and all that, mm-hmm. like, you know, I read the instruction book, and I saw, oh, it's The Adventure of Link. So I put my name in as Link. And, well, my brother wanted to have his own save file, but we couldn't have two Links, so that would be weird. So he put in Zelda. Mm. And that's how we discovered the fact that there was a second quest if you put in the name Zelda, and Link was holding the sword, and we were like, what does that mean?
That's awesome.
So he started playing it, and he never beat it because, you know, he got his ass kicked at second quest. But yeah, then eventually I finally beat the game. Then I had the sword too, and I was like, oh, that's what that means. Cool. But that was like one of the first like secrets I ever discovered about the original Legend of Zelda.
That's cool, dude. Randomly, when you first said Zelda memories, the first thing that popped in my memory. You guys remember the TI, like, 83
yes,
calculators?
Yeah.
Dude, I had Link to the Past on that. And
That's pretty ballin'.
Yeah, dude, I would sit there and I would play it. Somebody had programmed it all out. It was awesome,
the
dude.
Entire thing?
I don't think it was the full game, but I know, like, it had a decent amount of stuff. So, like, dude, that was, like, one of the first... I'd be sitting in class going around, and it looked like I was working on my calculator or whatever, and I'm playing Link to the Past.
That's amazing.
And then,
on A Link to the Past, which is a phenomenal game.
Right.
I remember the music in the forest when you are finding the Master Sword for the first time. I love the music in the forest. I can't remember it right now. I just remember I really, really enjoyed it. So, I don't know. There's all sorts of memories I have from Zelda. But
I'd sing it, but I'd sound like an idiot.
No, go ahead. Yes. I always thought like some squirrels needed to be running around while this goes like
a fanciful forest adventure.
That's right. I don't know. It's so great.
Zelda always has good forest music, man.
Yeah, I think that's it's true. It's true. But
if we're going to Link to the Past, I know I've shared this memory before, but I'm going to share it again. Link to the Past is still my favorite Legend of Zelda game, hands down. And one of the best memories I have of that is when it came out, and I was playing it heavily, is back when I was still in, you know, going to school every day. I faked being sick one day so that I could stay home and play The Legend of Zelda Link to the Past. Mom, I'm sorry. But that's what I did. And
I don't so feel sick. Good.
Yeah, and I just wrapped my blanket around me and just played Link to the Past all day. And I got to the point where I was in the graveyard trying to find the cape.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and to find the cape, you have to push over the graves and find one of the holes. Well, I did that on accident. Granted, I was like 8 at the time. So I pushed the grave, and the grave slides back, and there's little, like, skull and crossbones there. And as a kid, that freaked the hell out of me, so I immediately shut off the system.
Did you really?
And I had not saved that entire day. So the whole purpose for me staying home sick so I could play the game all day was immediately lost when the game scared me and I shut it off.
You're a weenie.
I have never had a game scare me to where
I was a young kid! Shut up!
You were 8.
I picture you like right now though, you know, like you're just like playing, and just like
fetal position.
What do you think it was gonna happen?
The skeleton's like, gonna
I don't know.
Me.
Was Super Nintendo possessed or
something? I didn't know about the cape at the time. I was just messing around the graveyard, and then the grave suddenly moved, and I was like, no, you can't do that.
Okay, hold on, Jared. You're pushing graves around. What do you think is under the graves?
I don't know. I don't know what I was thinking. It just happened. It all happened so quickly.
You need to be slapped. Really, eight-year-old self needs to be slapped.
If I could go back in time, just man up.
That's right.
There's a cape in there, goddammit, you go get it.
Yeah. Makes you invisible, God.
Man, and of course we're talking about Zelda. It's gonna bring us to Ocarina of Time.
Yeah, whatever.
What?
No,
I was like, don't do that, man. But when Ocarina of Time came out, my friend John and I, who's a neighbor. We both went out to get it at the same time, and like he grabbed the gold cartridge, right? And this is kind of a regret of mine. I was like, okay, well, I'll be different. And so I bought the gray one. You know, so now I still have the gray
now
one,
it's cool.
And he has the gold one, yeah.
Isn't the gray one more rare than the gold one?
No.
It's not? Okay.
The gold one's still rare.
Okay.
But, so we actually set up our 64s side by side and just started going through the game.
That's
right?
Awesome.
which was, yeah, it was badass. And so we were going through.
So stinking cool.
And,
it is cool.
It's awesome. It is. It
yeah,
is cool.
Exactly. So we're both going through the game and stuff. And, you know, so like if I find something, I'm like, oh, do this, you know, he can do that, or vice versa. And then I remember, like, he's like, all right, I'm going to go to bed. But this, I was like, no. Like, I have to at least get to an adult. Like, you know, like, because this is when Link can, you know, turn into an adult. I'm like, must get there. So, like, he goes to bed, and we're at his house, and I was staying the night over there. And I stayed up all night, like, till I finally got, and, like, I remember, like, I go through the whole thing, and, like, Link pulls the sword, whatever, he turns into an adult, the time goes by, whatever, I'm just like, yes! And, like, I save and just fall asleep, like, on the couch right there. And he came out the next day, and he's like, so where'd you get? And I'm like, I'm an adult now. And he's like, what the hell? Because I'm, like, way ahead of him.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yes, there's so many good memories from Zelda. It's just, I don't know.
It's resonated with me throughout my entire life.
Good topic. Good topic for sure.
Definitely.
Very nice. All right. There goes. There's the middle segment. Good topic, Will, this week.
Oh, we mentioned Zelda, so I think we just kind of have to say, fuck the water temple, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Some other topics this week were underrated games.
Uncharted.
First cheats ever and why, box art, cartoons, Steam, and Zelda was which we chose. All right.
So as always, if you want to put in your own two cents for what you would want us to see us talk about in the middle segment, you can go to the forums at screwattack.com. You can find one of the forums in the show discussion. Put a post on there. Or put a link to us on Facebook, on Twitter, on the YouTube comments, whatever. If you want if there's something you want us to talk about it, just let us know. You may be.
You might make it on the wheel.
Yes. Yeah. All right, there you go. Middle segment.
That was the middle segment.
I just get.
This is build up.
Did your Mac die?
No. Right now. It's time for the SciScroll News Desk.
Hit the music. He's staring at me all week.
It was a fast one this week. All right. Here we go.
Huh? Yeah.
What?
That's what she said.
Okay, yeah, good. All right. Let's go to first story. New York, New York. Where this is just a quickie this week, and you'll understand why
I
use the terminology. Hold on. Because a condom maker is taking the...
Oh, no.
The phrase sex sells... Sex sells, uh-huh. Sex sales, very seriously, in the form of, he is now...
I just saw the picture.
Yes. He is now taking celebrities, bands, high-profile people, and putting, with their endorsement, of
course. Condoms on them?
Putting their face on condoms, or
What? Like the rapper, you mean, right?
No, the actual condom.
What?
Take, for instance, this.
Oh my God!
Gene Simmons condom with his face on your penis, and his giant tongue, going down the. It's pretty interesting.
This is all kinds of inappropriate.
Well, I think that the youth of America need to know that if you're not going to be abstinent, you need to use Kiss condoms.
Oh, Sean Connery! What?
So Gene Simmons and Kiss, who, by the way, people say he's a brilliant businessman, but that guy is such a whore. Gene Simmons is all over the place, and
he's protected.
He will literally put his face on anything, including your dick, which is absolutely amazing. I'm just saying. Wow, good job, Gino. So this guy plans.
Are you gonna do like video game versions?
If there's a Master Sword.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
Yeah, that's right.
I don't know if Nintendo would give their stamp of approval on
probably
that.
Probably not. Buy it. Just saying, Nintendo, if you want to make money.
That'd be incredible. The Nintendo seal of approval. I'm just saying.
Or extra pleasure. Sonic rings.
Oh, Chad, really?
So many ways we can go with this. Wow. The guy says he's talking with entertainment companies, energy drinks, and designers to put logos and messages on condoms. So way to go there, condom guy.
Is it safe to print on condoms? Like,
that's something we don't know.
I think it's best we not delve into the logistics behind this.
That's okay. Right. There will not be any sort of...
Because that could be hilarious if, like, they fail, like, really bad. Like, there's this horrible fail rate. And you're like, Gene Simmons gets, like, half of America pregnant, you know? Like,
damn you, Gene Simmons.
Gene Simmons is in his mansion.
Yes!
Yes!
Alright, now let's go to Jacksonville, Florida. Home of what? Retirees.
We always have crazy alligator stories.
Well, this is not an alligator story. This is actually a guy who is from New York, right? A New Yorker in Florida on business with two guys, okay? He is making a sandwich when he's talking to his wife.
Sounds like a good time to me. Okay.
When his wife says, "Honey, American Idol is on." Guess what happens? He gets excited. So you're in a room making a sandwich. You love American Idol. There's two other guys that you're traveling with watching TV. What's the first thing you do?
Burst out into song.
I would eat the sandwich.
No. How about put a knife at one of their throats and tell them to change the channel?
What?
Oh, yes. Baron Prakash from Brooklyn, New York, was preparing a meal when his wife told him he was on the show. He asked the guy to change the channel. They're like, no. And
what are you, gay?
He then got out a butcher knife
Jesus.
And held it to the guy's throat and threatened to kill them if they did not change the channel, which was pretty amazing. So police were called, and Parkash or Prakash or whatever his name is, Psycho, I guess is the better term, is sitting out in the hall when police show up, and they say, "Sir, you need to get down." And he says, "No." And then they have to forcefully take him down, where they go inside and they find a butcher knife. Which he put to the guy's throat before they disarmed him, in the trash can.
The guy really loves Ryan Seacrest.
Did he get to watch American Idol?
No, he was. No, that's the worst part of that.
Did he get American Idol in jail?
He was. Yeah. He was booted outside. He was booted outside the hallway, so he didn't even get a chance to see. He didn't even go
down
to like.
That's
sad. Yeah, I'm just saying. You can probably go to like a sports bar and watch it. I don't know.
No, he said like he was making the sandwich and then he held the knife to his friend's throat. So in my head, like right away, he was like, you know, making a peanut butter jelly sandwich. He just happened to be using the butcher knife.
Butcher knife? I was thinking the exact same thing.
And then as soon as he said that, he immediately just leaps to his friend. Change the channel!
You just see this just, never mind. All right. Anyways, he has been charged with aggravated assault.
Good.
With a deadly weapon.
Yeah.
Without intent to kill. Which,
with intent to watch.
I'm just saying, if you hold
a butcher knife. Is there a charge for still watching American Idol? There should be.
All right. On that note, let's go to a much better story. In Scottsdale, Scottsdale, Pennsylvania. I think everyone's gonna love this one. Okay. Scottsdale, Pennsylvania. As I can finally get it out of my mouth. We are going to go there when a man, who he's been watching a lot of G4, because
that sucks.
He's into ninjas. And,
Ultimate Warrior or Ultimate Ninja Challenge, whatever.
Ninja Warrior.
I love that show.
Well, he's apparently been watching a lot of Ninja Warrior on G4 because that's pretty much what they have rolling 24 hours a day now, besides cops. but he left his 4-year-old son sleeping in his house to go outside
and ninja train
and play ninja by himself. The 28-year-old man was outside pretending to be a ninja.
The 28-year-old. I'm a ninja.
Yes, when I first read this story, I was like, if he was like, I don't know, a really young dad, like, he had when he was like 15 or something, you know, 15-year-old, he had a kid when he was 15 and he's like 19. I can see you being, you know, 19 and playing ninja outside. Maybe not with yourself, but I'm just saying, at 1 a.m. in the morning, probably not the best thing to be
doing.
Did
he like have one of those obstacle courses built or something? Yeah. Like,
it's in the backyard. Yeah. He's got a full pulley system where he's riding trains and stuff. Police said he showed up and the guy said that he told his mother, he asked his mother to go watch the baby while he went out and played ninja, but the mom was like, I don't even know what you're talking about.
I was given a mission.
Yeah, well, he went out and completed
I told
his mission.
Her, but I told her so stealthily she doesn't remember.
Any ninja vanish?
Yes, exactly. Cops are coming, or child services, you know?
in an affidavit, patrolman Joseph Lane said he asked Hunt, hey, why are you playing with yourself? And around 1:30 on March 3rd, this is just last week, and he replied that there are not a whole lot of people who want to play ninja.
Aww.
So he had to play by himself. And the cop's like,
was he training for Ninja Warrior, or just pretending to be a ninja?
Just pretending.
Did he have like weapons or anything, or he just?
I think it was just outside doing a kata, like Karate Kid 3.
Cool.
Just in outside, outfit, of course.
God.
He's yeah. Wearing all black. Look how cool I am.
trying to live his life like a Kamehameha, right?
Oh God!
Don't you dare.
Tell him.
Don't you dare say that, sir. Anyways, he was apprehended and he's due in court on March 30th. So, way to go. I'm just saying, if there are things you want to do at 1:30 in the morning, playing ninja, probably dressed in all black in the middle of the night in your backyard, it's not the best thing to do. Yes, especially when you have a 4-year-old. So,
waiting. So for future reference, got it.
Just saying, just letting you know. Ross Hurst, way to go. All right, there you go. That's the news desk for this week.
All right.
So what do we do after the news desk? Forum question.
It's time for my awesome transition.
as the computer boots up.
All right.
Did I say we have Reboot or Retro on the site at the opening of the show?
Nope.
Well, we got Reboot or Retro. I just saw it when Chad opened his computer. So make sure you go see Reboot or Retro on Contra Hardcores. Is it hardcore or hardcorpse?
It's hardcore.
That's what I thought.
It's a pun.
Yeah, what?
It's a pun.
Is it?
Because hardcore, core being like a military group of people or whatever. Yeah. But hardcore because the game is so difficult. It's hardcore.
Well, people are saying in the comments that it's hardcore, which doesn't make any sense at all.
The English language doesn't make any sense at all.
Right.
Well, it's hardcore.
It's pronounced core.
It's hardcore.
Suck it, internet.
All right, first up, The Lies of Andor wants to know, what game would you start a child with?
Oh, easy.
Not Ninja Gaiden from the last story.
No. No. You know, I would start with exactly what I started. You got to go off self-experience, and my self-experience was starting with Super Mario Brothers.
That's exactly what I would say.
Got to start with the basics.
Mario Bros. Duck Hunt.
Run to the right and jump.
Get some good hand-eye coordination in.
Yeah, probably start with some NES classics, the original Mario Brothers, and then slowly elevated.
You can't really do Duck Hunt now because no TV will allow you to shoot your gun. You
so got Time Crisis instead.
Yeah. A little hardcore there between.
You know. I guess you know before. Before Mario, I did actually play a little Intellivision. I had an Intellivision, which was pretty good.
I still have an Intellivision.
And I played a little bit of that, and that was pretty basic. I remember the control sucking even when I was a kid, but... Mm-hmm.
I remember playing games like Olympics on a Mac my dad had, you know, or like Commodore 64.
I would introduce kids with the most basic stuff possible.
Yeah.
So that they appreciate how good...
Retro, dude.
How good the games have gotten. And I know there's a lot of people out there like, oh, you just retro fags, whatever. No, but it's about learning the respect so you don't take for granted exactly what you're playing today so that you realize how great graphically they are and how good gameplay they are.
Yeah, well, yeah. At the same time, you don't want to overstimulate them. Like with all these like new high-end flashy graphics and all that. Just start with the basic, you know, bright blues of Mario.
You start with the crap. Graphically,
yeah,
and you work your way up. I mean, like,
these are good games because you'll appreciate them. Because otherwise, yeah, if you do it backwards, you're gonna be like, "What the hell is this?" You know, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
You can beat Legend of Zelda. You'll be able to beat Gears of War 6 any day.
It's true, but you know, like I think in terms of racers, you put them in like an Outrun or something like that. Outrun is I played Outrun on like the PC, so I think it makes total sense. So, anyways, whatever. All right, I think that's good.
Cool. All right. Next up is a video question from G1 Coyote.
Hey, Screw Attack. G1 Coyote here. Just saw the AVGN's 100th episode and was thinking about how the nerd was the one that brought me to Screw Attack about 4 years ago. My question is, how did Screw Attack and the nerd join forces? Thanks for everything.
I appreciate you vanishing, Mr. Plastic, yes. Coyote.
So that's what you look like, Coyote.
I see. Excellent. Wonderful. Good question. We get that all the time. We joined forces with James, man, a long time ago, actually. Right after Screw Attack started up, I was just strolling through YouTube when YouTube was just a baby, and found this guy's videos, and I think he had two videos up, and
The Angry Nintendo Nerd?
Yes, the Angry Nintendo Nerd had two videos up, and I thought they were really, really funny. And they only had like 2,000 views on them, and I was like, wow, this guy's really, really funny. I don't know how they only have 2,000 views. And so I shot him an email, and I remember actually showing him to a couple friends, and I was like, what do you think of this guy? And I was like, because I think he's hilarious. And one of them was like,
he sucks.
You know, he's kind of a one-trick pony, and he's not very funny. You know, it's not really my thing, whatever. And I was like, I think this guy's a genius, you know? And the other guy was like, yeah, he's okay, whatever. And now those two guys are like, he's hilarious, that guy's the shit. So it was pretty much just an email and said, hey man, you wanna work together? And he said, yeah, sure, of course. And kind of the rest is, you know, there's obviously been other things along the way, but that's kind of how it went down. So started with a simple email, that's what it starts with, so.
Good times,
all right. Yeah, good times.
Next up is a video question from Danny VL Acme.
Hey guys. Danny B. L. Acme here with a two-part question. First part, which game were you looking forward to that really ended up disappointing? Second part, which game were you not looking forward to that actually ended up impressing you and becoming one of your favorites?
Okay, I'm gonna let you guys start with this one because I don't really know where to go with this other than that Danny B. L. 8, whatever. Danny V. had a cool thing he held up.
Okay. For a game that I wasn't really looking forward to, but became one of my favorites, was actually the original Dead Space. Like, when that came out, that was a real under-the-radar game, and I kind of looked at it, and I was like, oh, that might be cool, I might give it a try, but I wasn't, like, super hyped for it or anything. But I ended up playing it, and I loved it, and, you know, I picked up Dead Space 2 right away and played the hell out of that, but the original Dead Space, probably one of the more recent ones. One that I was looking forward to and didn't like...
Processing.
I would say Final Fantasy 13, but I wasn't really looking forward to that one that much.
You're already bracing yourself?
Yeah, we may have to come back to me for that one, but
okay.
Yeah, give me a second.
One that I was really excited about, but then I got disappointed, was Naughty Bear. Because, like, I love Conker's Bad Fur Day. It's one of my favorite games ever. And so when I saw all the Naughty Bear stuff, I was like, oh, hey, maybe it's going to be... Like, I mean, obviously it wouldn't be Conker, but it would be that kind of humor where they know it's a game, so they kind of joke around, you know, do that stuff. So I got really excited, and then it was just bad review. Destin hated it. I played it for like a second, and I was like,
Yeah.
So that one really disappointed me.
After giving it much thought, here's my official statement. I only play games I'm interested in. And I got to be really interested in a game to buy it. Otherwise, I'll gameplay it or rent it or whatever. So, you know, I can't really... Nowadays games, I can't really say, because, you know, I don't buy a whole lot of games. We get a lot of games at the office and I'll play them here, you know. So, it's tough to say nowadays, but I know, just through trial and error, there were a lot of games that I was interested in, you know, back in the day when I was buying a lot of games, but I would still rent them.
Mm-hmm.
Same type of thing. I can't give you any exact titles other than... Yeah.
I can tell one game that I wasn't too excited about originally, but then, you know, is now one of my favorites, Mario Party. Like, the original,
really?
Like, way back. Well, I mean, because, yeah, back then you're like, I was like, what the hell is this? You know, like, it's, you're Mario, but you're playing a board game. I'm like, this is going to be stupid, you know, and then you play it, and you're like, this is fun as hell, and then you break your hand on the controller.
You know something, you know, actually, there is a game that I've actually was disappointed in, and actually, I got to thank Jared for this, because, Jared actually bought me Mario Brothers All Stars for the Wii, which was, it came with the CD, and it came with the Super Nintendo game, which I was disappointed. I was gonna get it because my wife loves Mario, and I was disappointed because it's literally an emulated port, in that the Super Nintendo controller is the controller you see when you're selecting.
Yeah.
Your game.
Like, no effort was put into it.
Zero. So that game actually disappointed me because, you know, like, I was hoping, I think I was like a lot of people in that, and I was hoping that the games would be redone with like Wii graphics and such when it was initially announced, and then it was just like, okay, here's a port, and here's a CD. There you go. So.
Anyway. Yeah, it still came out on disc, which is what
Yeah,
really
exactly.
Strange.
It should have been downloadable.
Right.
Yep.
So, all right, what else?
All right, next up, G1 Thamiel, I think is how you say it.
All right.
If you could combine the setting of one game with the gameplay of another, such as a Mario tactical espionage game or a Metal Gear platformer, which two games would you pick and why?
Don't think I've thought about this before, because I have.
Oh, let me just list.
I haven't actually thought about what games would not work well, and games like a fighting game RPG, that would not work well.
It could, but it's never been done well.
Combined, okay, exactly.
Closest thing I could think of would be Hybrid Heaven for the N64, where you got into like one-on-one fights, but like as like people hit your arm would get stronger and more defensive, or you attack that leg will do more damage.
Mm-hmm.
That's like the closest thing I could possibly think of. It was not done very well.
I'm just imagining, you know, like walking around like a Final Fantasy with your party, and then all of a sudden it's like,
fight! Going to a one-on-one
fight.
Yeah.
All of a sudden you gotta throw fireballs, and the action goes insane for, you know, 30 seconds, and it's whatever.
Street Fighter Double Dragon. A Street Fighter beat-em-up. I think that could be really cool. And if you didn't go into, like, the fights, that, I think, could get pretty tough.
No, they actually, there have been some fighting games, or some beat-em-ups, where you've had to input commands to do certain attacks. So there have been plenty of those. I can't think of any off the top of my head, but yeah.
Dungeons & Dragons, Shadows over Mystara, had, like, Street Fighter-esque button commands. You do like down to forward attack and do like a sword uppercut and stuff like that.
Yeah, so they've done stuff like that and it's been okay. It's nothing's been flawless. The thing is, when you have the down to forward and the forward to back and back to forward and such, you really got to be on a 2D plane so you can understand exactly, you know. Otherwise, you might go down a little bit.
I think it'd be kind of fun, though.
I would say any some sort of RPG with in a beat 'em up format would be awesome. I don't know what one specifically, but I think that would work because beat 'em ups are great.
Kind of like right. River City Rampage,
like River City Ransom or Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, Rampage. But some other RPG franchise like Final Fantasy into a beat 'em up setting instead of just a city where they're doing fights.
Mm-hmm. Good question. Good stuff. Yeah. All right. So was that it?
That was it for forum questions, but oh my god, do I have a lot of birthdays.
All right, okay, before you get to birthdays, let's talk about the stipulations on how we can actually get people, because they're going to have to start earning it, because these are really,
it's
going to take like 3 minutes before we get done with the birthdays. So.
Find Screw Attack on Facebook and like us, and then, like us on Facebook, it'll send us an email when it's your birthday.
Yes.
And I should get that, and I'll put it on, and... I will read your name.
We'll include it in the description, the description below. You can actually find the Facebook page. And so click that, go to it, like us, and you should be good. You'll be able to keep track of all the stuff, and we'll be able to keep track of your birthdays and stuff, hopefully.
All right.
We're not big Facebook guys. We don't really know.
Yeah. Let's do this. I'm going to go kind of fast, so I'm probably going to screw up some names. So enjoy my mispronunciation. All right. Ryan Mallett, Steven Sokolsky, Andrew McMillan, Jesse Guerrero, Brett Vanderbook, and then Bobby Crandall as well.
That bastard.
Leo Kovalik Jr.
Inside joke.
Mr. Alice Snow White, I guess that's his Facebook name. Ryan Polton, Anthony Moulis, Matthew Daugherty, Jeff Williams, Alberto Espinoza Perez, Justin Hunter, John Luke, G1 Klipzig, Crimson Fox XM, DE Digital, I think. G1 Seether, Jikoku ROA, whatever, Toriyami, Kyan Kaiser, I told you there's a lot.
Sweet lord.
Cinnamon Mini, Thamiel, and StarGeek13. So happy birthday to all of you guys. Congratulations on your existence. Oh my god, there's
all
a lot of
25 of you.
You're going to have to start earning it from here on out. I'm just saying. We're going to figure something out. Make you guys earn it. I guess, I don't know. They are kind of G1s, they're pretty awesome, but...
This is true.
We can't spend half the show. We can't spend half the show doing birthdays, so...
We'll find out something.
Alright. Oh man, I've been having the drainage issues in the throat today.
That sucks.
I've been doing a lot of coughing. But whatever. Alright, there you go, that is...
Let us leave you with that.
Yes.
Side scrolls.
That is Side Scrolls for this week. Don't forget, I will not be here next week. But Brian will be. What up, Bri?
Hey.
Yeah.
Hey.
And that'll set the tone for next week's
Brian's side gonna scroll. Be here next week. Everybody, that's gonna be it. So until next week, hey, I'm Stuttering Craig.
I'm Chad.
And I'm Professional Jared.
See ya!